Praise the living God, dear heart. Thank you for joining me again on Holy Ghost Fire Talk. I'm your host, Evangelist King, pastor at House Shalom. You know, at House Shalom, we're simply building God that peaceful house for his glory. Now remember, his house, his building, his tent, his dwelling place is our body. Our body, his temple, dwelling place of the Holy Ghost. Therefore, dear heart, God will not coexist with demons in his house. Paranormal investigators, psychic teachers, it's okay to coexist with them in your house, your tent, your building, your dwelling place, but not God Almighty. You don't desire just to have our spirit only, but he desired to have our spirit, our soul, which is the mind, the will, and emotion, and our body. Praise the living God. And it should be our desire that he have all of us, the whole man. You say, man, that means woman too. The whole person and not just certain portion. So I'm continuing the total man, part two of an analysis of the human personality. You know, in part one, we were taught that man is triune. Spirit, soul, and body have three parts. The soul being the mind, the will, and emotions, and the body. So Psalms 8 chapter verses 4 through 6 and verse 9 say, again, what is man that thou art mindful of him? And the son of man that thou visit him? For thou hast made him a little lower than the angels and has crowned him with glory and honor. Thou made him to have dominion over the works of thy hand. Thou hast put all things under his feet. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. And remember, we are always in God's thoughts. We're always in his mind. Just like God is a triune being, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, we too are a triune being. Now, the Father's mind, dear heart, is actually the Holy Spirit. So we always is in the Father's mind. Why? Because the Holy Spirit dwells and lives in us. And the Father's body is Jesus Christ. That's his body. And the Lord reminds us that, again, that we are always on his mind. And I prefer to be on God's mind than any human being's mind. Because you know why? God cannot lie. He say he loves you, he loves you. He loves us. We may be made a little lower than the angels. That's because of this earthly body here. But he had crowned us with his glory and great honor. The angels of is our ministering spirits. God has given us dominion over all the works of his hand. Delegated authority to the believer. We just only believe and use the authority that God has given us. He has put all things under our feet. Why? Because everything is under Jesus' feet. Remember, Jesus is the body of Christ, of the Father. And Jesus, by his Spirit, is in us. So if everything put under Jesus' feet, that means put under our feet. How excellent is his name. Now, again, the human person will not doer. That means we just don't have a mind and body. That was taught many years ago. That's the reason why it's very difficult for some people to believe that we try our being, spirit, soul, and body. You know, psychology can evaluate different dualistic concepts of a person, and they're the one who figured that a person is mind and body, inside and out. But it's not true. First, we need to know and understand who we are as the human personality. You know, some of us, we think we know the evil personalities, but yet still we're clueless about the human personality. And that's the reason why we have a tendency to blame our brother and sister when they do us wrong and when they sin against us or when we see them do wrong. We have a tendency to judge them because we don't really understand who the human being is. That's why some people prefer to be amongst animals instead of human beings. But dear, I'm here to tell you, God did not die. Jesus Christ did not die for animals. He died for human beings. Also, the death is not the end for the human personality. Physical death is not the end. Some people believe that it is, so they try to eat, drink, and make merry on this earth because that's why I'm going to die. Like, that's the end. That is not the end. Then it's the beginning. Now, the Christian world needs a clear understanding to differentiate between what is spirit, what is soul, and the human personality. We need to know that different. What is the spirit and soul in the human personality? It is of great significance and supreme importance for the spiritual health of the individual and the church to know the difference between soul and spirit. Now, otherwise, how can the church know what is spiritual and what is carnal if they don't know the difference between the soul and spirit? In the unveiling of what is spirit and what is soul, we face the old and the new creations. 1 Corinthians 15, chapter verse 22 say, "For as in Adam all die." That's the old creation. Now the new creation is saying, "Even so in Christ shall all be made alive." See, that's the new creation. And we need to know that when we accept Jesus Christ, completed work on Calvary, we are a new creation in him. But we need to know that difference between the old and the new creation. In the new life of the last Adam, who is Jesus Christ, we learn about spiritual warfare, how to battle successfully against evil. The Holy Spirit teaches us in God's word, because a battle is not against a human being, a human personality. A battle is against spirit personalities, evil spirit personalities. Ephesians 6, verses 10 through 18 say, "Finally, my brother, finally, done all you can do. What can I do, Vince King?" The Lord just told us, be strong in the Lord. Finally, after you've done all you can do, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Not the power of our might, but the power of his might. It says in verse 11, put on the whole armor of God. And you read that in Ephesians 6 chapter, put on the whole armor of God. Why? So that we may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil, those evil personalities, evil spirit personalities. We're able to stand against them. 12 say, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood. And we not wrestle against human personality, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. These are evil spirit personalities. The evil spirit personalities don't have a human body to express themselves. Now we have a human body to express ourselves. We're spirit. We're soul. Have a mind, will, emotion. We have this body to express ourselves. 13 says, wherefore take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, having done all to stand. We'll be able to stand in the evil day. It could be right now, evil day, it could be now. Evil day could have been yesterday, could be tomorrow. But the way we're gonna stand, we have to put on the keep on the our spiritual uniform. The Lord clothes us in the spirit realm with the spiritual uniform. The uniform of God. In the earthly realm, we seem to have more respect for people in a uniform. But dear Lord, we as children of God, we have a uniform that we never take off. We wear that uniform 24/7. That is the armor of God. 14 says, stand therefore, having your loins girded about with truth. That's our uniform. Having on the breastplate of righteousness. That's our uniform. And our feet shod with the preparation of the gospel's feet. That's our uniform. Above all, taking the shield of faith, which is our uniform, wherewith we shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. This is our uniform, dear Lord. And take the helmet of salvation, which is our uniform. And the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. That is our uniform. Praying our way with our prayer and supplication in the Spirit, which is our uniform. And watching thereunto with all perseverance, which is patience and supplication for all saints. That is our uniform. That's the uniform that is put on our spirit bodies. Spirit body. In the spirit realm, we put that uniform on. And we keep it on. Don't take it off. Don't take it off at night and call yourself putting it back on the next morning. No, you keep it on. The spirit realm, you always dress in that spiritual uniform. So that when the devil shoot his fiery darts, and the wicked shoot their fiery darts, but we have it on our spiritual uniform, we're able to squinch. The fire of the Holy Ghost squinches those darts. You have to keep that uniform on. Now, again, in order to understand this, we have to know that we're more than just a mind and a body. The spirit, dear Lord, you just see my body here. You don't see chair. I'm a spirit. You're a spirit. Within our spirit, within our body, we have that soul, which consists of our mind, our will, our emotion. And quite naturally, we know about the body because we see the body. You know, we believe because we see the body. We can't see the spirit. On the time we know about the mind, will, and emotion is when we act and react. Then that's when we experience a person's mind, will, and emotion. We experience what's in their mind when they react by talking. And their will when they do something. The emotions is when they react again. Because you know, we have to remember that we're trying just like God. Because remember the Lord said, let us. Like yes, like in part one, when I was sharing how I used to ask the Lord that question, my young, who are you talking to? And I was young and finally got my answer yesterday. I heard the Lord in my spirit. He was just like, I'm talking to you now. He said, I'm talking to myself. And I was like, oh, God. And I shared with you in part one how God said he was talking to himself. He said, let us make man in our own image. So who is us in our? The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. But they are as one. So they said, let us make man. So God said, I'm talking to myself. Praise his holy name. So don't think everybody's crazy who talk to themselves. No, we're talking to our Heavenly Father. So this is the announcement of the human personality. Again, we must understand it first before we can even understand who God is, before we can accomplish the mission, the goal, the purpose that God has for us. We must even understand our own self, who we are. When Jackie Chan got this movie, who am I? You know, he couldn't do anything because he could never figure out who he was. So we first got to know who we are. And the Holy Ghost is teaching us who we are. We are more than just a mind and body. We spirit, soul, and body. I believe the vital messages for believers in this hour is for born-again disciples to have a biblical comprehension of the difference between soul and spirit. Remember, the soul is the mind, the will, and the emotion. Spirit is the person. Then we have this body. Only through our spirit can we know spiritual reality. It is impossible to have proper spiritual development and maturity without an understanding of the functions of the soul and spirit. Until a Christian can tell the difference between soul and spirit, he or she will more than likely live in the soul, which is the lower life. How are we living in their mind and their will and their emotion? That's the lower life. Then they will not be living in the spirit, which is a higher life. That means we won't be living in our spirit, who's in partnership with the Holy Spirit. We're supposed to be living in our spirit, abiding in Christ through his Holy Spirit. That's where we should be receiving our information from, our instruction from, not our mind. That's where we should be hearing God from, our spirit, which is in tune with the Holy Spirit, and not from our mind, will, and emotion. That's the lower life. It's impossible to constantly walk in the spirit unless you know what is spirit. Okay, now this is small spirit. This is us. When I say spirit, now when I'm making reference to the Holy Spirit, I will either say Holy Spirit. But if I say spirit and I'm making reference to the Holy Spirit, I say capital S. So you know the difference. Galatians 5 verse 16 say, this I say then, walk in the spirit, capital S. That's the Holy Spirit. While in the spirit, capital S, that's the Holy Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Be careful when people say, my spirit tells me. I'm like, your spirit, who your spirit in partnership with? Because our spirit can be either in partnership with the Holy Spirit or with Satan through demon spirits. So be careful, person said, well, in my spirit, I'm well, who are you talking about? Who you in partnership with? Talking about in your spirit. In the spirit realm, there are three types of spirits. There is the Holy Spirit, the devil and his spirit, and there are human spirit. So you telling me in your spirit, so who your spirit communion with? Okay. But the Lord said, if we walk in the Holy Spirit, which is in the spirit, capital N, then we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. We will not if we walk in the Holy Spirit, in the Spirit. Always fellowshipping and communion with him. By walking in God, love, holiness, a disciple of Christ does not walk in darkness, sin, or rebellion against God. Now, I'm going to share with you this graph chart that Pastor Lester Sumrall written out for us to help our understanding regarding the basic and fundamental understanding of mankind. The soul is the captain, remember the soul, in other words, the captain and the pilot of the ship, but the spirit is the owner and the body is just a slave. Okay. So here's a chart, and it's a good chart that the Holy Spirit revealed to him to show us the analysis of the human personality. So remember now, we are a spirit, we have a soul, which is mind, will, emotions, and we live in the body. So let's start first with the human spirit. Remember, the human spirit is like like the captain or the pilot of the ship. I'm sorry, the spirit is the owner. The spirit is the owner. Put up here. The hemisphere is the owner. Okay. Then the soul is like the captain or the pilot of a ship. Now give us physical analogy to help us understand the spirit. That's necessary because our mind is so limited. He have to do that. He used that all the time. When he walked this earth, he used natural analysis so people could understand. So again, we have a spirit. The human being have a spirit, which is actually the owner. The Greek word is pneuma. I think you pronounce it pneuma. P-N-E-U-M-A, pneuma. That's the Greek word. Now, the last Adam is Jesus Christ. Romans 8, verse 11 saying, but if the spirit of him, that's capital S, that's the Holy Spirit, of him, because Jesus Christ was full of the Holy Spirit. His spirit was full of the Holy Spirit. But if the spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you and me, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken our mortal bodies by his spirit, by the Holy Spirit that dwell in us. 1 Corinthians 12, chapter verse 8 say, for to one is given by the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit. That means the same Holy Spirit. See, our human spirit works alongside with the Holy Spirit. Galatians 5, verse 22 and 23 say, but the fruit of the Spirit, that's the Holy Spirit, is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and temperance. Now, the human spirit is the spiritual fulfillment, intuition, communion, conscious. It lives in the Spirit, that means the Holy Spirit. It walks in the Holy Spirit. It prays in the Holy Spirit. It sings in the Holy Spirit. It reigns with Christ. It's more than a conqueror. There's no condemnation, no guilt, no worry, no fear. When the human spirit abides with the Holy Spirit, also it's a royal nature, Revelation 1 verse 6, and had made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Also, the human spirit is priestly, has a priestly nature. Proverbs 20, verse 27 say, the spirit of man is a candle of the Lord, searching all the inward parts of the belly. John 7, verse 38 say, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Out of his belly, that's the spirit. It's not talking about the stomach. Stomach just an organ in the body. But the belly is the spirit of a man. Me, woman, too. And only the Holy Ghost can dwell down in a person's spirit. Remember, he said the spirit of man is the count of the Lord, searching all the inward parts of the belly. You see? So we are spirit, dear heart. And the Holy Spirit, again, works with our spirit. Okay? Now, also, we are spirit, but we have a soul. Now, the Greek word for the human soul is psuche. And I may mispronounce it because I'm not a Grecian. Not good on pronouncing words and I'm not familiar with, but it's P-S-U-C-H-E. That is the human soul. So that's the first Adam, the human soul. Soul consists of the mind, which is a person's intellect. their brain, their thought, their evaluation, their self-consciousness. The reason why you just saw me do that, because I deal with God's dear children. And I see they live more in their soulish realm than in the spirit realm. The hemisoul is the emotion, which is the feeling, the desire, and the mood. Also, the will, the volition, that's decisions. Galatians 5, verse 19 say, now, the works of the flesh are manifest, or the works of the flesh are made known, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, confusion, self-righteousness, self-examination, disappointment, defeat, discouragement, immaturity, impotence. Again, dear heart, I'm telling you, the last 7 years I've been dealing with God's dear children, and I see they walk more out of their soul realm than the spirit, than by the spirit who reside in their spirit, because they're always going by what they feel, their emotions, what they feel, what they desire, their mood, their intellect, their brain. And sometimes I get like Christ. Jesus even said, how long must I put up with your unbelief? So we need to start walking by our human soul, by our mind, with much about, but walk according to the to our spirit, who is in partnership with the Holy Spirit. And our new life in Christ Jesus is in our spirit. Now, the human soul is the first Adam. But we can bring our soul in subjection to our spirit by the Holy Spirit who dwells in our spirit. But that requires us to keep abiding in Christ Jesus. Keep hearing his word, not the words of those who don't believe and those who doubt. Because our faith in God's word must become stronger and deeply rooted deep down in our spirit, when you say in our heart. Now, I'm talking about this human organ, but the heart of a man is the spirit of a man. Again, talking about woman too. Glory to his holy name. So we have to walk by faith, and all this requires faith. That's why the devil get us to try to love to walk by our soul, our mind, will, and muscle. It don't require faith. It requires what we see, what we touch, what we taste, what we feel, what we smell for us to believe. The Lord said, we ain't gonna get nothing from him. Because only faith that pleases him. Now also, there's the human body, which actually, that's the lowest of them all, the body. That's the slave, actually. Because the body is the one who does put forth the action to do. So the Greek word for the human body is soma, S-O-M-A. The body is and always has been a servant and a slave. The body does, body is supposed to do what our spirit tells to do, who is being led and guided by the Holy Spirit. But we're not walking in the Holy Spirit, in the Holy Ghost, then our body going to do what our soul tells us to do. It's our mind, will, and emotion. And you know what, dear heart? Satan knows that he can gain access to our soul and our body. He cannot gain access to our spirit once we are born again, because the Holy Spirit abides there. But he knows he can get an entrance into the soul, which is a mind with emotion, and the body of a person. He knows that. So that's why he tried to get us to focus on our soulless part, which consists of our five senses. He gives a focus on what we see, what we don't see, what we hear, what we don't hear, what we feel, what we don't feel, what we touch, what we don't touch, what we taste and what we don't taste. Because he knows if he can get us to walk according to our soul and our flesh, hey, he got a chance to enter in. So the body will always be a servant slave. Now, when I was young and the Lord wanted to teach me this at that time, which I really didn't take time out to meditate on what the Lord wanted me to learn, because my mind, it was so confusing. I just said, forget it, instead of just sticking to it. But anyway, I think it was a few years later, I was praying. And I had learned from a believer. When you pray, when first it comes down to petition, request, asking the Lord of something, he said, don't pray out loud, because the devil is there to hear it. And he'll counterattack it. So the devil can't read your mind. So you just talk to God within yourself. In other words, the devil don't know what I'm telling God. So I started doing that. So this particular day, I was doing that, and me and Jesus had a conversation. It was like just me and him were there. My spirit was communion with him. I'm telling you, it was though my spirit was right there with Jesus in the spirit. And we were just fellowship and talking, had a great time. Then all of a sudden, I heard this voice. And I'm like, who is that? And I looked at Jesus, I said, I know that it's not the devil, because the devil don't know what I'm talking about, because I'm not saying it out loud. But I heard a voice. Who was that? You know, the Lord told me, he said, Terry, that is your flesh. I said, what? I was literally shocked. He said, it was my flesh, my body. He said, didn't you know that your flesh, your body, is a totally separate entity? I said, what? And that's when I realized that our flesh body is a totally different entity. And the scripture tells us what the body, the flesh, desires. It does not desire the things of God. It desires the things of the evil one. That's why we must remind that flesh that it's been crucified with Christ Jesus. But I share that to show you how. That's how I found out that the human body, the flesh, was a separate entity. It's the slave. And it's a slave to sin. You know, we desire. That means our spirit desire to do good. But something within us, which is that flesh, want to go do contrary. So, hey, since now we learned that if the body, the flesh, is a servant, a slave, it must do what its master say. And if our spirit is yielded to the Holy Ghost through us, we are its master. And we must command it to act in obedience to the word of God. But see, if you don't know these things, you don't know that your spirit, soul, and body, you're just going to live a life of confusion. You're never going to grow in Christ Jesus. Never come to maturity. Because that flesh will not be a slave. It will end up being the master. It causes you to sin against God, to rebel against God. So the body is and always has been a servant and a slave. And it operates through and by our five senses: touch, taste, smell, hearing, and sight. You know, our five senses are very remarkable and miraculous, but they must be guided by the Holy Spirit, subjected or in obedience to the Holy Spirit. That's the flesh. Praise the living God. Now, what is the birth of the human spirit? The birth of the spirit of man. When a child is born into this world, his spirit is dead. When a child is first born. John 3, verses 3 through 7. Jesus answered and said to them, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, until a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." So that's our evidence that when a child is born into the world, their spirit is dead to God. And Jesus just said, unless we are born again, we cannot see the kingdom of God. Verse 4, Nicodemus said unto him, "But how can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born?" Verse 5, Jesus answered, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit," I mean the Holy Spirit, "he she cannot enter into the kingdom of God." Verse 6 say, "That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit," which is the Holy Spirit, "is spirit." Verse 7, "Marvel not that I said unto thee, ye must be born again." So we must be born again, dear heart. Now, what is the answer to the conflict between spirit, that means the human spirit, and the soul? Ezekiel 36, verses 26 and 27 say, "A new heart will I give unto you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will put my spirit within you, and call you to walk in my statutes, and you shall keep my commandments and do them." How else can man fulfill God's plan for his life? This is the only way, dear one. We must be born again. Jesus will give us a new spirit. He will put his spirit in us, and we'll look just like Jesus on the inside. Glory to his holy name. His spirit in us causes us to abide and walk in God's statutes and his commandments and to obey them. That's why we must be led by the Holy Spirit. We must follow the Holy Spirit. We must abide in the Holy Spirit. We must obey the Holy Spirit. Then we are sons of God. When I say sons, I'm talking about daughters too. Glory to his holy name. Now the birth of the human spirit in our lives. Romans 8 verse 10 say, "And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the spirit is life because of righteousness." Amen. When the spirit of the living God is in us, Jehovah, we are alive in Christ, alive unto God. We've been reconciled to our Heavenly Father. We are his son. I mean daughter too. By his son. The coming of his spirit into our spirits. Romans 8 verse 11. "But if the spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal body by his spirit that dwell in you." See, that's the coming of the Lord's spirit in our spirit. When we receive him and become born again, that's how we're born again. We have the DNA of our Heavenly Father, and it's the Holy Spirit. And the same spirit that quickened Jesus from the dead abides in us. And he shall quicken our mortal body. That same spirit, why? Because he dwells in us. The Holy Spirit in us, actually, you know what a down payment is. Some of you might not. The down payment is, for instance, you know, you want to get a car, you don't have all that money up front. They say, "Well, just give a down payment, and that'll hold that car for you." You say, "Okay," so you give that down payment. And you rejoice because that car is yours because you gave your down payment. So you're just waiting until the time to go purchase it, to redeem it. Well, the down payment of the Father is his Holy Spirit. in us. That's Father down payment. We belong to him. And one day he's coming to redeem us. Glory to his holy name. God's spirit, like the dove that north from Noah's ark, searches for a place to rest. Genesis 8, verses 8 through 12 say, also he sent forth a dove from him to see if the waters were abated from off the face of the ground. But the dove found no place for the sole of her foot, and she returned unto him into the ark, for the waters were on the face of the whole earth. Then he put forth his hand and took her and pulled her unto him into the ark. He stayed yet another 7 days. Again he sent forth the dove out of the ark. And the dove came in to him in the evening, and lo, in her mouth was an olive leaf plucked off. So Noah knew that the waters were abated from off the earth. And he stayed yet another 7 days and sent for the dove, which returned not again unto him anymore. Praise the living God. The dove returned to the ark until there was the new creation. God also prepares a place in every Christian for himself. It's a new creation. It's not old, but a new creation in Christ Jesus. Again, as I share from my experience of dealing with God's children these last 7 years, most of God's children really work from their soul realm. So is Christians as worldly people. Because people of the world operate through their soulless realm. Should not be amongst God's children. Really, people are sinners and function only in body and soul. And it's a shame when Christian functions only in body and soul. So is Christians have body, soul, and spirit. But the spirit is dormant so that the Christian is motivated by his soulless comports rather than his spirit man. You hear that? The Holy Spirit. And our spirit is dormant. Why? Whenever, again, we are led by our soulical parts, mind, will, emotion, and in our body, that means that the Holy Spirit dwelling in our spirit is dormant, just laying there. Can't do anything. Can't do a thing. And it's really sad. And that's why you see there's no spiritual growth in the body of Christ. That's why you don't see many sinners coming to Christ Jesus, because his children living from their soul realm and their body and not from their spirit, who is in partnership with the Holy Spirit. Spiritual Christian, they do not live in the soul, but by the human spirit, because the Holy Spirit leads and guides them. Their spirits are fused with God's spirit, you see. Instead of the Adamic soul controlling the spirit, the human spirit now controls the soul and body. See, our human spirit, along with the Holy Spirit, is supposed to control our soul and body. Man's spirit can become one with God's spirit. Romans 8, verse 11 say, but if the spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, but if the spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his spirit that dwells in you. So God's spirit that dwells in our spirit quickens our mortal body. It helps us. Helps us in becoming obedient unto God. Now, how do we get from soul to spirit? Now, here's our two testimonies of two men that will help us And I thank God for every child of God who the Holy Spirit has given them spiritual experiences in helping us to with our walk in Christ Jesus. So there was Watchman Nee, a great man of God. This is what he said. We must know that he who worked for God is the one whose man can be relieved. The basic difficulty of a servant of God lies in the failure of the inward man to break through the outward man. If we have never learned how to release our inward man by breaking through the outward man, we're not able to serve. Nothing can so hinder us as this outward man, that means the body. The body is the outward man. The soul is the outward man. But the inward man is our spirit, who's in cooperation, partnership with the Holy Spirit. Whether our works are fruitful or not depends upon whether our outward man has been broken by the Lord, so that the inward man can pass through the brokenness and come forth. This is the basic problem. The Lord wants to break our outward man in order that the inward man may have a way out. When the inward man is released, both believers and Christians will be blessed. Also, the testimony of T. Austin Sparks says, what is man? What joy and strength there is when the soul having been constrained to yield to the human spirit, who then partnership with the Holy Spirit. The high wisdom and glory is perceived in its vindication. So that unto fullness of joy, the soul is essential. It must be brought through the darkness and death of its own ability to learn the higher and deeper reality for the which the spirit, the human spirit, is the first organ and faculty. The human spirit, again, who works along in partnership with the Holy Spirit, is the first organ and faculty, is the one who's in control, is the pilot. Now, what's the problem? Man was not supposed to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil for the development of the soul. Right. But he was supposed to eat from the tree of life for the development of the spirit. That's why the Lord said we are forever learning. And it seems like we're forever learning, but still not learning. Why? Because we are continuing to eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. I always want information about a thing, but never coming to maturity in Christ Jesus. But we are supposed to be eating from the tree of life. His word is life. For the development of our human spirit, not the Holy Spirit. In the Old Testament, when the children of Israel wished to offer themselves in full sacrifice to the Lord, they did so by sacrificing a penguin, dove, or lamb to act as their substitute. The first thing there, Aaron, the high priest, did was to take a sharp knife and cut it up. Now, today, we don't bring doves or pigeons or lambs, which were only types of the real sacrifice. But we bring ourselves in full surrender. But the procedure is similar. For our high priest, not after the order of Aaron, but after the order of Melchizedek, takes a knife sharper than any Old Testament high priest had ever used and divides between our spirit and soul. Hebrews 4:12 tells us, the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing or separation of soul and spirit, that's the human spirit, and of the joints and marrow, that's the body, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Now, the joints of marrow could well be referring to the effect of this operation upon our bodies, flesh and blood. That's the word of God. Amen. Now, again, we are spirit, soul, and body. Man is made in the image and likeness of God, tripartite, spirit, soul, and body. His soul is also tripartite. That means three, our soul, our mind, the part of our mind that makes decisions, which our volition, our will, the part of our intellect that thinks, so it's intellectual, our emotion, the part that help us to feel, that's emotion. Try as you might, you will not find a fourth component of the soul any more than you can add to the Godhead or to add a fourth component to spirit, soul, and body. The spirit also can be divided into three components. You got intuition, which is knowing without thinking it through, as does the intellect. You got communion, that's fellowship with the Father, with His Son, and with the Holy Spirit. We have conscience, that bearing witness with the Spirit, or grieving, quenching, or resisting the Holy Spirit. See Romans 9, verse 1, Ephesians 4, verse 30, 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 19, Acts chapter 7, verse 51. Amen. Now, how do they function? Body and soul are subject to death. Why? Because of sin. So that sin, they shall die. The spirit, which is the human spirit, is a substance from God. God is the Father of spirits. Hebrews 12, verse 9 say, furthermore, we have had fathers of our flesh which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much rather be in subjection to the Father of spirits and live? The spirit, the human spirit, is in the unregenerated human, is dead, alienated from God, inactive, non-related, but not extinct. So actually, ungenerated human spirit actually is a zombie. Mm-hmm. You thought zombie was not real. Devil know they real. They devil tried to make a mockery and a laugh by making movies so you can think it's not real, but they are real. They are zombie. When one is not born again of the Holy Spirit, ungenerated human, they actually is a zombie. They are alienated from God. They're walking dead. Body is alive and active on earth. And their spirit is dead. So they separate from God. They're just merely walking. Devil got their spirit chained and bound up. A zombie. That's why in the natural realm, they're not happy. They try to make themselves happy, thinking they can accumulate this, that, and another, give them happen, but only happens only last for a short period. And they're sad again. And they turn to drugs, sin, turn to violence, to sex. Some end up killing themselves. Discouragement. They're a zombie. So again, the human spirit in the unregenerated human is dead, alienated from God, inactive, non-related. Not extinct, it's not extinct now, but they are inactive, alienated from God, separated from God. So they're walking me. And I thank God for His grace and mercy and waking me up one day. And when He woke me up, that's when I realized that in the spirit realm, it was like I was asleep. And the devil had himself a good time with me. I'm telling you, when God woke me up in that spiritual coma, I tell you, it felt like I just woke up. I mean, God did it quickly. I was just, my body was in the kitchen doing this, that, and other. All of a sudden, I said, why did it feel like I just woke up? Nobody in the house but me, but I was talking out loud. I literally felt like I just woke up. And then when I asked, I was talking in my spirit. And the Lord answered me. It was His grace and mercy that woke me up. And I said, Lord Jesus, thank you. When I said that, I just looked up and said, devil, I'm awoke now, and you are in trouble. That came out of my spirit. And look how God had used me. That's why He worked very hard for you not to contact me for your deliverance session. Because He knows when you get connected with God's true servant, Jesus Christ is going to catch those demon spirits out of you. So He tells you to stay away from her. Don't contact her. Because I'm not a zombie. I'm not, no longer a walking dead. Glory to the name of the Most High God. The human spirit, once renewed, the heart is alive. You see, I came alive. I was like, devil, you are in trouble. I'm telling you, it felt like I just woke up. Now, in the natural, I know how I feel waking up from a natural sleep, but this was a spiritual sleep. I felt it. And I told the devil, you are in trouble now because I'm awoke. But every human spirit that the Father say, it's time now, He touches them. And they waken in the spirit realm. And God leads them to their human helper to become born again and to be delivered. You know, that means that person now is alive and the devil is in trouble. Glory to His holy name. So the human spirit, once renewed, is alive. It is clothed with soul and body, which are mediums of expression for the spirit, for the human spirit. And that's why Satan and demons don't have a body, and they want medium to express themselves. And we know how they want to express themselves. To kill, to steal, and to destroy. And that's why the devil's got to be cast out of that soul realm, out of the body. So that the Holy Spirit through our spirit can be expressed. A body and soul would be used as a medium for our spirit and the Holy Spirit to express themselves. The natural soul is manifested and sustained in this life by the body. A sick body can destroy the manifestation of the mind, emotions, and will.
I found this on the web for buy candles to I do manifestation.
Excuse me.
Check it out.
You know, the work that happened because I didn't ask that to do anything. That was the devil. You know, he is a lie. So remember that a sick body can destroy the manifestation of the mind, emotions, and will. It can. I've been sick. And praise God. Thank God for the prayers of the saints on earth, prayers of saints in heaven. They constantly pray for me. Because when you're sick, then the devil can prevent the manifestation of the Holy Spirit working with your spirit and expressing God's actions and reactions through your body and through your soul. It's your mind, will, emotion, and body. The human spirit enters reality by the soul and body. The human spirit exits the human through natural death or sin. The importation of eternal life is through the engrafted seed of the living word, who is Christ Jesus. James 1, verse 21 say, wherefore lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word which is able to save your souls. 1 Peter 1, verse 23 say, being born again, not corruptible seed, but of incorruptible by the word of God, which live and abide forever. The incorruptible seed is the deathless vehicle for soul and body, the spirit, the human spirit. Conscience is spirit. By it we know the laws of God, that it dictates law to the soul, which enforces it. The modern world is void of pure conscience, but lives by soulless mental powers or methods. The soul looks for numbers to count. Souls are always looking for numbers. I think you're on Facebook paying attention to how many friends you got. That's the soul. Always looking to count something. Even in members in your church, your roster, pastor, every week you ask them, how many we get today? So that's the soul, always looking to count number. You know, David caused a punishment to come upon himself by counting numbers. That's the soul. The spirit seeks the fruit of the holiness, peace, and joy. So instead of counting numbers, the soul won't count numbers, but the spirit, it seeks the fruit of righteousness. Always seeking the goodness of God. That's the spirit. Now, heart and spirit. What is heart conversion? What is there in us that needs God? There are three main words that describe the nature of man. Again, spirit, soul, and body. And God needs all of us. Remember what I tell you, Lord told me, Tara, I have some of you, but I don't have all of you. And he had my spirit. He didn't have my soul, which was my mind, but wasn't much my body. Why? Because demons were coexisting or living in those areas. And the Lord desired not just my spirit to live in, but my soul to live in and my body. So there are three main words that describe our nature, that is spirit, soul, and body. And God needs all of us, spirit, soul, and body. Man through his body can contact the outward world. How do you think the world is going to see Christ? Through our body. I mean, we have to act just like Christ. When they look in my eyes, they should see Christ. No devils, but Christ. When they listen to me, when they touch me, they should see Christ. So again, man through his body can contact the outward world. Through his physical senses, he is world conscious. Through our physical senses, we are world conscious. Because the world cannot see Christ. The world can only see Christ through us, the hope of glory. Man through his soul is conscious of himself, able to know himself. Through his soul, he is self-conscious. Man through the human spirit has the capacity to know God. Through his human spirit, he possesses the capacity to be God conscious. Excuse me, do you see me? I'm trying to monitor something over here, so don't pay attention to me looking over there. So again, man through the human spirit has the capacity to know God. Through our spirit, we have the capacity. There's no limit in knowing God through our spirit. Through his human spirit, he possesses the capacity to be God conscious. That's why we're always conscious of God, because of our human spirit. Man, threefold expression. Our threefold personality can be compared to a corporation. Hold on a second, dear one. Let me finish this and I'll stop looking over here. Okay, just a second. All right. Okay. Well, threefold personality can be compared to a corporation. Give us an understanding. In the corporation, you got the plant, you got the office, you got the president. So we're going to talk about the plant. The plant, which is in the factory, there may be a large assembly room where many people work at producing the finished articles. This department will be the human body, okay? Now you have the office. There's also the business office where secretaries and various assistants work. It's a place where correspondence is answered, orders are made, decisions are carried out. This will answer to the human soul, okay? Now you got the president. Last of all, there is the inner office where the president of the firm resides. In this main office, all the major policies and decisions are made. The main office illustrates the functions of the human spirit. In the fallen man, however, the governing office has been taken from the spirit and transferred to the soul or to the body. That's what saving life. When a man is unsaved, the heart of man is not identified with the inner man or inner spirit, but with a man's body or mind. The mind or body was never meant to rule the personality. No, the human spirit in partnership, communion with the Holy Spirit, was meant to rule the human personality. Why do you think you find people always in that emotion? You offended me. You hurt me. I don't like what you said. I don't like what you did. You did such and such. See, that person living from their soulish realm, from their body, soul and body, and not from their spirit, through their communion with the Holy Spirit. They are a soulical Christian. An artist once said, "Well, as far as I am concerned, art is my God." He was knowingly transgressing the first commandment by that kind of attitude. His heart was in painting and drawing pictures. If that man's artistic skill had been taken out of his life, it would, as we sometimes say, have taken the heart out of him, because that was his God. Art, drawing, was his God. While on board a ship sailing through the inside passage to Africa, Mr. Sumrall said, he once asked the captain, "What do you think of Christ? Whose son is he?" Then he said, the captain said, "Those stars are my God, sir. Since I was a small boy, I have lived on the high sea, and night after night, those wonderful stars have guided my boat. They have never led me astray. To me, they are the most beautiful things in the world. I admire them deeply and perhaps even worship them." So, Dustin Raw asked the man, "But who made your sparkling gods up there? Who organized their function to guarantee that they stay in their orbits and remain faithful to you?" And the man said, "I do not know. And I'm not sure that anyone else knows." Then Lesson Ross said, "Captain, my God made your gods." Dear heart, I'm not going to worship the creation. The creation is so beautiful. So if the creation is so beautiful, then how amazing is the creator who made the creation? Glory to his holy name. I'm worshiping the creator. So when a person feels the claims of Christ to rule him, and at the same time sets his heart on some sinful affection, his condition produces a divided heart. A divided heart. You know, God has given us gifts. God has given you an artistic gift. But you don't take that artistic gift and make it your God. No, Don't worship the gift. Worship the giver of the gift. He's amazing. Because the gift can come to an end, but the giver of the gift cannot. Praise his holy name. And God do not want us to have a divided heart. Again, when a person feels the claims of Christ to rule him and at the same time sets his heart on some sinful affection, their condition produces a divided heart. We discover this truth when we have to make a decision on spiritual issue. What is going to be the ruling center of our life? A divided heart must choose who is going to rule. The heart can be involved in an alien interest, affection, possession, ambition, or reputation. These can claim the heart and control the personality. That's why, dear heart, we must also be willing to give up our reputation. That's why committing you don't come for a delivery session, because one of my requirements is for it to be videotaped and recorded. And you're not willing to give up your reputation. So that means you have a divided heart. It's your God, your reputation. Yourself is your God. And that's the reason why the Lord had me to do it that way. Because he don't want nothing to be ahead of him. He's first in our life. He said, thou shalt have no other gods before him. He's a jealous God. So actually, it's for to help you to give your reputation. We cannot receive the things of God and keep our reputation. We have to give our reputation up. Just like Jesus gave up his reputation, we must give up all. No matter what choice is made, the heart does not lose its moral contact with the conscience, which is part of the human spirit. Even when the heart is far from God, the spiritual capacity of conscience remains in man and makes itself known in a man's thoughts and feelings. We see the difference between the scriptural word for heart and spirit. These words are often used in the same verse in scripture. One example is Psalm 34, verse 18. The Lord is nigh unto them that are of a broken heart, and saveth such as be of a contrite spirit. Now there is a scriptural difference between the two words, heart and spirit. Small hints of the human spirit. Perhaps the main difference is the heart is always the ruling center of the personality. Everything about a man is related to their heart. Proverbs 4, verse 23 say, keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. The word spirit, again, as a small s, does not necessarily indicate a ruling disposition, but rather the spiritual capacity every man has for God. The spirit ought to be the ruling center of our personality. However, even when God does not rule in man's spirit, the spiritual capacity still remains. Praise the name of God. So remember, dear heart, we are a spirit, we have a soul, mind with emotion, and we live in this body. And the ruling capacity should be our human spirit, who's working along with the Holy Spirit, who leads and guides us into all truth. And again, it requires faith in God to do that. That's why we live by faith. We walk by faith. That's why without faith, it's impossible to please God. We can't see our spirit, so we have to have faith. That's who we are, spirit, soul, and body. So we first need to get an understanding who we are. And once we understand who we are, then the Holy Spirit can use us. And we learn who we are in Christ Jesus, also who Christ Jesus is in us. And because the world who cannot see God will see God through us, through our action, through our reaction. When they even look on our bodies, they'll see God. It's a shame that the world looks on God's children's body and see their body just like their body, full of pins and needles, full of printed pictures and words on the body. You know, false things on the head, false hair, false lashes, false hips, false butt. That's a shame. When the world look on God's child and see such a, that's false. So the world can only see using their five senses. They see through their soul-solical realm. So again, when you look at God's child who decked with falseness like that, then it's going to lead them to falseness. And Satan represents falseness, deception. No, we are holy people. We are separated, set apart for God's use. Holiness on the inside, holiness on the outside. Glory to his holy name. Praise the name of the Lord. So dear Lord, thanks for tuning in to Holy Ghost Fire Talk video podcast. Remember, you can tune in to watch this live teaching of the Total Man on our website at theholyghost.tv. Again, theholyghost.tv. You can watch the live broadcast as well as the video on demand. So from time to time, just drop by theholyghost.tv. So dear heart, stay blessed in Jesus' mighty name. Shalom.